Now, just to recap before we speak about what is in my heart this morning, remember yesterday we spoke under the topic Anointed for More. I gave 4 points there. Number one, I said, you must have a revelation, you know, of who you are in Christ. Very, very important, because as we continue to labor and we face challenges in life, it's very simple to forget that who is the one who called you into this ministry. I said, acquire information to get an exposure. You know, sometimes our comfort zone can actually make us to think everything is well, yet it is not well. You are only seeing where you are. But the moment you get information, you move around, check what is happening in your surrounding, it's going to change your thinking. And I said, get out of the pond. You know, comfort zone, it's a beautiful thing. But the truth of the matter is that dreams, they die when you are in the comfort zone. We end up not achieving what God has put inside of us because we are in this pond. And I said, make room for more. I strongly believe that there is still room for more. If we can just avail ourselves and say, Lord, make use of me, and you'll be amazed what the Lord will do. And we concluded, you know, with the story of a good Samaritan. I'm saying this because this story really transformed my life. When I was reading that, I felt over the years the Lord saying to me, Christians are good Christians, but are not good citizens. We are good Christians, but we are not good citizens. And on that story, two projects, you know, were birthed in the past 5 years based on that story. And the first one was Devoted Citizen. After ministering on that story, I felt the Lord asking us to challenge the church, to say, it is not good enough just to pray. Take care of the environment. You know, people, they must be taught not to litter. They must be taught to take care of their environment. Care for one another, you know. And the list is bottomless. Basic things, which is something that we overlook. We are more into spiritual things, and then we overlook basic things, even in the body of Christ. And then we started this campaign. It became a movement. Some of you were aware we were even involved in these elections. We had over 300 people who were observers in these elections from our church, because we said to them, let us get in there. We can't just take a back seat and complain. You know, leadership will come from the house of the Lord, and we can impact this nation. And we see that happening right from the school level. We're teaching kids from the school, primary school, and then to become devoted citizens. Basic things that people can actually overlook. I don't know, probably here, but in Joburg, our children, they can't even identify the traffic light when it says red, simply means stop. You know, those basic things to say, be a good citizen, take care of others. And the second project that came from that scripture, it's a foundation, People Matter Foundation. And this is a foundation that we've opened, you know, to the body of Christ, because what has been troubling my heart and other few people, and without taking anything from the gift of the givers. But I always ask myself, if you've got the gift of the givers, where's the body of Christ? When you have the vehicle of the gift of the givers, where's the body of Christ? I mean, recently, right here in Eastern Cape, many people have lost their houses, and it's business as usual. Instead of coming together and we go to a place, sometimes we don't even have to pray, but we just go in there, we rebuild someone's house. You know, we rebuild the community. So People Matter Foundation, and then was birthed from that place or that concept to say, we come together and we started building houses for the destitutes. And then when there was floods in Durban, we went in there, we restored houses, even the churches that were destroyed by floods. And we felt this is what the church should actually do. And we are restoring this into the body of Christ, because we strongly believe that for years the church has taken back seat. And not only that, but I've also realized that even as we work as a church, but we work as individuals. You know, that other church is doing work there, that other one is doing work, that other one just under the umbrella of a local church or under the name of the church. But we have not elevated, you know, a standard where we say, let us come in, just like the gift of the givers. You know, they are just doing this for the Islamic agenda. And it's just the question of time, by the way. Maybe I just need to mention that just to give that awareness in the body of Christ. You know, to say ANC, when they were in exile, they were a government in waiting. And when time came in, they took over. Islamic is also a government in waiting in this country. All the things that they are doing, they've got an agenda. So it is very important for us to unite. So I'm saying this because this is it's a meeting for the pastors to say we've got those projects. They are not under my name. It's for the body of Christ that we need to unite like never before so that we can make an impact. Imagine if we have gathered like this together and then after this meeting and then we go there where people are affected by the floods. We identify two or three houses and then we build it to the glory of God. And the church will make a statement that we are here not just to collect an offering, but we are here, you know, to present or to represent the kingdom in an excellent way. And while you have that in mind, I want to talk to you this morning under the topic, the next level leadership. The next level leadership. I have used my slides in a different way. I hope they'll come nicely. You'll get everything there. And I need to say, I was inspired by what happened in Dubai. But before we go there, let me mention some few things here about the next level leadership. Life was never meant to be lived in one level. I strongly believe that. Doesn't matter how much you have achieved. If you come to another level, it is not the heart of God that you should camp in that level because there is still more in God. It's not God's, you know, will for us to live life in one level. But I need to say that unfortunately, most of us, we have come into this level, we got stagnant, we got comfortable in this level, and all that we do now, we just maintain the level that we are in. We just maintain the level that we are in. I've seen when I was traveling around that sometimes a pastor would just be happy, you know, with the salary and the building and the Mercedes Benz. That is the dream of African pastors. If I can have a building and have a Mercedes Benz and a salary, success. And they are comfortable. And all that we do now is more about maintaining what we have. But I am here this morning to challenge ourselves to say, it does not work like that. It is not the heart of God. Just before I give you the scripture, let me give you the points, give you the bit of the movie, and we'll start acting it. We go back at the end of the movie. Here are the points I wanted to grab. Number one, the level you are in determines the life you live. I just want to put that very clear. The level you are in determines the life you live. As a toddler, you cannot eat meat because you are at the level of a toddler. You'll only feed on milk because you are at that level. But when the toddler begins to grow, get into another level, they will eat something else. Number two, we live and behave according to the level, you know, we're in or we choose to be in. It's all about levels. If you are in a certain level, you will behave at that level. And nobody's going to question you because you chose to remain in this level. Number three, you can't lead people to a level you have never been. Please have this in mind. You can't lead people to a level you have never been. That is why most of the time I'm extra careful to criticize people in another level because I have never been in that level. I used to criticize pastors and then who do not have time for people. It's like these guys, they don't have time. He's always busy until I was at that level. I realized that you cannot just preach and then after preaching and then you must still avail yourself to the people because people, they want, I thought these pastors were arrogant. Here's the man of God, you just preached, but you can't speak to the people. I didn't understand that until I was at that level. And I realized that after preaching, I don't want to talk to anybody because you give a lot. But the truth is that you can't lead people to a level you have never been. Doesn't matter how much you desire, you know, these people to be in this level. You first must be in that level for them to be where you are. It begins with the leader. And a number four, every next level of your life will demand a different version of you. Every level of your life will demand a different version of you. You cannot go to another level with the same mentality because it's a different level altogether. And the last one here, you'll always get tested the most before you progress to the next level. Every level you fight a different devil. Somebody put it like that. So while you have those things, because this is where, it's what I want to conclude with at the end of the day. This is what I want to achieve at the end of the day. You might miss everything, but my message is on those 5 points. If you grab those ones, I am okay. Now, I visited Dubai and I got more information. I was really, really encouraged and also studying more, you know, about Dubai, how these guys achieve so much in 50 years. Now, I've got some pictures there of Dubai. You look at the first one in 1970. This is how Dubai looked like, if you can just project that. This was just in 1970. Dubai just looked like this. And in 1990, after the liberation, it continued to look like this in 1990. And then go ahead, look at the Dubai now. In 2003. And in 2007, this is how Dubai looked like. And 2012 and beyond, this is how Dubai, actually in 2012, this is how it looked like. And the other one, I think you've got that one there. This is my favorite picture because I used to preach about this and I had a desire just to go and sleep in that hotel. And by the grace of God, I slept there. But you look at that, there was nothing there. There was nothing. And these guys, they are not Christians. They are not Christians. And they've achieved this in just 50 years. And you ask yourself, how come? This is the question that was actually asked to Mohammed bin Rashid, the leader of Dubai. When they ask him and say, how did you achieve this so much in such a short space of time? And listen what he said. He said, we in the UAE have no such word as impossible. It does not exist in our vocabulary. Such a word is used by the lazy and the weak who fear challenges and progress. Just a Muslim guy there just gave us a lesson. He says in our vocab, we don't have the word impossible. And he said, we strongly believe that what has been given unto us by God, we can make use of it. He continued to say, you know, to me, the desert was not an obstacle, problem, or challenge to be overcome, but an opportunity to create a new sector in the country's economy. He said, with these two resources, the desert and the water, he said, we can actually change the whole economy of the country, because somewhere in 2012, they were told that your oil cannot sustain you anymore, and what are you going to do about your situation? This is when they got some engineers all over the world. to come and give them the solutions. The engineers came in and said, we can put soil, we can put your desert in the water, and then we can start putting some buildings right there. And people, they love to own houses in an island, and that is how Dubai started flourishing. It took a man who had to go into another level of thinking, which is something that is bothering me. I don't see much of that in the body of Christ. I don't see much of that in the body of Christ. Even in our government, I don't see much. The last time I was challenging the guys, I said, how do you feel? You go to Dubai for holiday, and then you come back to your country. There is nothing that is troubling you. There is nothing that is troubling you. You always go. The last time I came back, Pindi, remember, I was sitting with the premier of Gauteng, coming together from Dubai, and then here he was. We are seated together, and then I was saying, any challenge, anything that challenged you here? The guys, they don't see anything. There's nothing that is bothering them. Now, when you read in the book of Exodus, while we're going to take some few points, because I strongly feel that this is what the Lord did with Moses. The guy was stagnant. The guy, for 40 years, he stayed with his father-in-law. He had a permanent job of looking after the flock. He thought, this is how I'm going to retire. This is how it's going to be with my life. I have tried something and it never worked, and this is how it's going to be. But in chapter 3 of Exodus, listen what it says. It says, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side. We're talking about leading to the next level. He led the flock to the far side of the wilderness, and he came to Horeb, the mountain of God. You cannot come to the mountain of God and remain the same. And the Bible says, there the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. You see, people will draw closer if there's a bush that is burning and it's not burning up. That is how we attract people. There is this fire that keeps on burning. And people, they'll draw closer because there is this fire that keeps on burning. Verse 3 says, so Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him, you know, from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here am I. Do not come any closer. God said, take off your sandals, from the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Verse 7 says, the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their sufferings. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians. But it's amazing when you read verse 10, it says, so now go. God, you're concerned about them. You've heard their sufferings. And you says, you have come down, but I must go. Very strange, eh? He says, I'm concerned and I have come down to rescue them, but I must go. He says, I must go. Now, on that scripture, let me just summarize with 7 qualities that you need for the next level based on that scripture. Just simplified them. I strongly believe that if you want to be in the next level, number one, you must be a next level leader. You must be a next level leader. A next level leader is a leader that senses the shift in the spirit realm and lead accordingly in spite of his past. This guy was in the desert. He was working for his father-in-law. But from nowhere, he sensed the shift in the atmosphere. On this day, the Bible says, from nowhere, he led the flock to the far side. Not yesterday, not 3 weeks ago. But when there was a shift in the atmosphere, this leader sensed the shift of God in the spirit realm. As leaders, it cannot be business as usual. You cannot sleep facing that direction yesterday. You wake up in the morning, you are still facing in the same direction. You must sense the shift of things in a season. Because otherwise you would never be in the next level. So it begins with you as a leader. Wake up in the morning and ask God, God, what are you doing today? What are you up to today? What are you up to this year? You lead the flock to another level, because for the flock to be in another level, you first, you must be in another level, in the spirit realm. When you read the scripture, it tells you that, you know, Saul was the tallest among them all. When God was about to choose the leader, he looked at the one who was tall, although he was tall physically, but you know that it does not just refer to the physical tallness, but he was saying in every area as a leader, you must be the tallest. In your prayer life, in your understanding things, you know, your influence, whatever change, you must be higher than, your thinking must change so that you can lead people into that level. So you need to be a next level leader. You don't talk ordinary things. You don't think the same, because you are a leader into the next level. Number two, what I've discovered here is that you also need a next level courage. You need a next level courage. As a leader, you must be courageous. You must be prepared to break limitations and step into the unknown. In verse 3, it says, so Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? I don't know, Pastor George, if you remember, 15 years ago in the conference of Church of the Nation, I preached on the very same scripture. And what I love with this verse, verse 3, it's more unique in a Zulu translation. I don't trust English translation, but there's the Zulu translation. It gives the whole concept. In the Zulu translation, it says, Moses said, Magengi pambuge. Magengi pambuge. To pambuga, it simply means to lose your mind. It's like he says, let me just lose my mind and cross over. Let me do something that was never done before. Let me do something that there's no reference to it. Nobody did this, but I will do this. I will go to another place where somebody has never been there. Unfortunately, we have left that work to the scientist to say these are the ones who must actually innovate and do things, and then we are taking the back seat. But this man said, let me just go over and see this strange sight. And it takes courage. It takes courage to go over to something that was never done before. And that is where things begin to happen. When God saw him, that's what the Bible says. When God saw him that he has crossed over, God began to speak. God showed up because he crossed over. I want to put it to you as a leader. Leaders must be courageous. Leaders must be courageous. Leaders take decisions. I know we might differ with this thing. The other thing that made Trump to be popular, it is because he makes decisions, sometimes crazy decisions. But that's what leaders does. You look at Zuma in this country. He makes decisions. He's courageous. Crazy courageous. Not educated, but courageous. So somewhere I'm asking myself, I don't know what is it. You know, sometimes education, as much as it can be a blessing, but I've realized that most of the time you analyze and you end up paralyzing the very same thing. Now with Zuma, he does not care. He does not care. He just stands there. He does everything. You'll see to it how you deal with that. He speaks whatever comes to his mind, and then he does. I'm not saying we must be careless, but I'm saying to you, it takes courage to be a leader. You must be decisive. You cannot be a leader and not take decisions. It's leadership. It's called leadership. You are not... What's the right way? You are not Mugabe. What is the right way? You are not a dictator. But you are leading. Read the story of Titanic, why it sank. The boats that came in to save the people. There was the nearest boat, the captain, very close to the Titanic. He would have saved a lot of people. But he could not decide. When they asked him, they interviewed him, he said, I thought it was people. When I saw Titanic drowning, he says, I thought it was people. You know, when people were busy, you know, waving like this, he says, no, we thought people were just dancing, were just celebrating. And then he could not even decide. But the guy, the captain who saved people, who came in after Titanic sank, he was decisive. And many lives were saved. That's what leadership is all about. Listen to this. Comfort zone is the killer of dreams, innovations, and destinies. That's what comfort zone does. Number three. I strongly believe that if you want to go to the next level, you need what I call a next level revelation. Or you can put vision. But for me, it is revelation. The ability to see what others can't see. Let me put it like this. If you can see what others can't see, you will have what others won't have. Leadership is all about seeing things that others can't see. Sons of Issachar, you understand the times. You read the times. You see what others can't see. You take them to another level. It is a prayer of every leader to say, Lord, show me the next move. Because a leader must always be ahead. Not only in the church premises, but as a business person. You must know what is the next move. I still can't understand, even right now, that almost the whole world, we are using Uber. And when you pay here, the money goes to America. I still don't understand that. It goes to America. They tell you how much they're going to take. And they take the whole profit and then they pay you a salary. And up to this moment, nobody in this country has decided that let us have our own Uber system. Until when? I still don't understand the whole of African continent. There's no car that we have manufactured ourselves. I know when I'm speaking about the car, it's a big project. We import toothpicks in this country. Toothpicks. We can't even make toothpicks. It's the next level of thinking. And I sit with these guys. I said, guys, come on. You can't even manufacture toothpicks. Everything from China. China. Socks, China. If we can check the labels here, most of you, it is China. I'm using this illustration to make us angry. Because we might look at the business and then laugh at them, but, you know, we also need to elevate our thinking. Because the people who are coming to our ministries, these are the thinkers. And they sit there, they listen to you as a leader, and they are wondering, you know, where are you taking me to? Can you take me somewhere? Can you lead me to another level? Because the truth of the matter, you cannot take me where you have never been. It is worse with this young generation. You cannot come on the pulpit and think you're going to preach anything, you know, from nowhere or from the computer or Google. Let me tell you, when you give the topic, they also go there and they can tell, oh, central sermon. It's not yours. So we are different. We are living in a different world. And that takes me to number four, that you must have a next level of thinking. If you want to be a next level leader, your thinking must be totally different. The next level leaders think kingdom. They think kingdom, not church as a building. Because that is the problem. You know, we need to fix this, because the leaders of today, they think church is a building. We put more resources into a building and then we don't build in the lives of people. Now, look at this scripture. Look at this scripture. Just for me to show you something. The Bible says in verse 5, you know, do not come any closer. God said, take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Can I put it to you that, you know, wherever God is, that place becomes a holy ground. So he says to Moses, take off your sandals. Somewhere, somehow, I thought Moses, in his mind, thought God was somewhere in the temple. But God deals with his mind. He says, take off your sandals, because where you are, that place is a holy ground. For me, I strongly believe we need to teach our people to say, everywhere there's a ground, there is God. That is why I'm very passionate about this. You know, everything that God has created, God must rule over that place. He must rule over that place. That ground belongs to God. Every department belongs to God. Hospitals, they belong to God. The Department of Education belongs to God. Every area belongs to God. These mountains must be claimed back, must be taken back, and be brought into the kingdom of God. But for years, we have allowed all these mountains to be taken, and then we've settled with a spiritual mountain. And the problem is, just like the children of Israel, when they stepped into Jordan, into Jericho, I mean, the Bible says the city was fortified. The city is fortified, yet the wells in the city were bitter. The water was causing miscarriages to the lives of the children. And the fresh water is actually outside. Somehow I feel this is what we have done as a church. We have fortified our places. And yet the fresh water is controlled outside by a thief out there. Yet we are here as God's people. It doesn't work like that. We need, as much as we fortify the city, we take control of the water. We were joking with Drem. I said to Drem yesterday, I said, I hope you are harvesting water now during this season. Because we have been praying for you guys to say, Lord, they don't have water. They don't have water in Eastern Cape. I pray that you are harvesting, Pastor Jay, that we are harvesting water as you have so much rain. But you see, I'm challenging you to tell you that we need leadership. Because the problem is not the problem of water. Sometimes we go to God and say, God, we need water. And God says, but you are just playing games with me. I've just given you so much rain. Your role is to harvest the water. Make sure that the dams, they are well prepared, they are well built, and then to keep the water. Unfortunately, the guys who are leading, they don't even think of that. I don't know how many of them are thinking about water now that we need to harvest. You know the problem that we have been in. We have been praying for you even in Joburg. Oh, God, because we've got friends here. Oh, Lord, Dremonds, they don't have water. Jay, they don't have water. And now God is giving you water. The question is, who is harvesting water? So I'm saying these things, you know, to challenge ourselves to say, you know, even when we do our seminars, as we do our seminars, and we need to teach this even to our children, even into the upcoming leader. I think it was Albert Einstein. Einstein, who said these words, "We can't solve problems by using the same kind of thinking, you know, we use when we created them." I love that one. We can't solve the problems by using the same kind of thinking we use when we created them. We need a new, different crops of people. Pastor John, I'm here. Pastor Mark, as I said, I don't know when you ask me, but this is my passion. I challenge the church to say, let us take our rightful position. In your business, at work, wherever you are, make sure you solve the problems. You solve the problems. People, they need to understand that when you are being employed, you are being employed to solve the problems. Not to sit on the telephone and evangelize on the telephone at work. There's time for that, but here you are at work. You cannot be in this environment and all that you are doing, you just want to share about the goodness of God. Yet the work has not been done. I don't know, maybe you guys, you're good here, but I find it difficult most of the time to employ Christians. Because most of the time there's no work ethic. There's no work ethic. And I'm saying we need to understand that if we're going to build this nation, and then we must have a different set of thinking. We must think in a different way. Number five, a next level attitude. A next level attitude. The Bible says, "Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham." I want you to notice something here. The God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face. He was in that place, but the moment God introduced himself, the whole attitude changed. He had to hide his face. That's what the scripture says. And I'm saying to ourselves here, we must have a different attitude altogether when we want to step into another level. The truth is, your attitude will determine your altitude. That is how it goes. When you read your Gospels, there's a lot of things that we can learn about the leadership of Jesus. Why he was a strong leader and a leader that made a strong impact. One of the Gospels, it gives us the face of Jesus as a man. The other gospel gives us the face of Jesus as an eagle, as a lion, and what is the last one? As an ox. Four faces of leadership from Jesus. When he was crucified, he needed the attitude of an ox. That body had to be strong. He was a visionary. He could see the future. When he prayed in John 17, he prayed like a visionary, praying even for us. There was a moment where he demonstrated the leadership of a man, of a sheep, loving people and engaging with people. But there was a moment where he had to speak as a lion. And unfortunately, over the years, the Jesus that we have presented, it was the soft Jesus. The sheep one. As much as we say he's the lion of Judah, but we have not presented Jesus as the lion. Something to think about. But as a leader, you must be able, you know, to monitor your attitude in different places. How should I handle this situation? How should I deal with these people? How should I deal with this environment? I think if you have not watched this program, Chasing the Sun, the part two one, I want to encourage you, you know, watch that. You know, leadership at its best. Leadership at its best. By Rassie and the team, the Springbok. I have never seen leadership demonstrated in this way. You look at the guy, he knows that now for the scrum, I need oxes. Because for a scrum, you need oxes. Not people who eat salads there. They must eat pap. And that's what Rusty did. He says, I need these ones. Because salad does not win scrums. You also need what he did. He knows that you must be a visionary. Who is the short guy, by the way? Yeah. I mean, he knows that in this one, you need the short guy. You need the one with the speed and all that. He positioned people accordingly. But the main thing that I've enjoyed with that program is when we were about to face France. He takes the speaker during the training. He says, guys, when you go into that field, this is the song that the French will be singing. This is the sound that you'll be hearing in the field. So while you are exercising, I want you to familiarize yourself with this sound so that whatever was supposed to be a strange thing, it becomes a normal thing to you, you know, as the people. So they step into the unknown, but already the unknown was known to them. It was not something new. It takes a leader who is in the next level to see the things ahead, and he comes back, and then he saw them here. And Jesus, he operated like that. And unfortunately, as the body of Christ, we have not stepped into these things. We have allowed these things to be taken by the world. But we don't do that. I don't see much of that. Look at the Germans. What they do. Already, you have the model of today. I was just checking the last time. We are in 2024. They've just made an S-Class of 2029. 2029 S-Class has been made, designed, you know, and conditioned. Simply means they design the car and they take the design of 2029 and they see the other dealers and they say to them, to the other companies, this is our design for 2029. So if you are thinking of designing this type of a car, forget about it because this is our design. And they make the car and then they put it somewhere. And all that they are waiting for, it is 2029 to arrive. 2029, when it arrives, they take that car, they release it and say 2029 model. It's a 2029 model to you and I. But to them, it is not. You know what they do? They step into the future. They study the future to say, this is how the future will be like. They design things according to the future. And they step back and live their lives with the future in mind. We need to elevate our thinking, ladies and gentlemen. If we are going to transform our churches, if we are going to transform our communities, if we are going to transform this nation, we must think the next level of leadership. Look where Dubai is today because of their thinking. When you go to Dubai every 6 months, there is a new building, totally different because their thinking, it is totally different. When they had floods now, which is something that took them by surprise, now they are busy with the solution to say these things must never happen again. But it's amazing that it took them only 7 days to fix their roads and everything was running. With us, a pothole will remain la and Nelson Mandela for 6 months until somebody gets involved in a car accident. When they die, that is when they come in, they fix that pothole. But the funny part is that we, We get used to these things. We don't even complain about them. They become part of our nature. I'm just steering you. I'm just provoking you this morning. Is that okay? In my last 5 minutes, you don't just need a next level attitude. You need a next level appetite. You need a next level appetite. An appetite for more. You can eat as far as your appetite. Margo, I looked at you yesterday while we were eating dinner. I said, what a beautiful meal, but your appetite, you just did so much. To us who has an appetite, I just enjoyed. I had to go for the seconds. My point is, if your appetite in the things of God is so small, God cannot give you more. He cannot give you what you cannot handle. Something is happening in this season, something that never happened even in the kingdom animal. We always knew that a crocodile in the water is very strong. You cannot attack a crocodile in the water. But since 5 years, from 5 years ago, things started changing because of an appetite. A jaguar goes into the river and it will take the crocodile from the river and it will eat the crocodile outside the river. And people, they wanted to make a study to say, this is something naturally, it never happened. What happened? And they discovered when they were studying this jaguar that, you know, the jaguar experience, it tasted the meat of a crocodile. It actually killed the crocodile, you know, and then also. And it ate the meat. And since it tasted the meat of a crocodile, it never had an appetite for anything. But it realized that the thing that I want, you know, it's in the water. And it will jump into the water and get the crocodile out of the water. The question is, how hungry are you? How hungry are you? If you are not hungry, you will never go into the deep. But if you are hungry, even when people say this place, church does not grow, you will grow your church. Sometimes we curse our own harvest. You go to a place and say, the church doesn't grow in this place. The Lord is listening to you. The Lord is listening to you. The moment you say the church does not grow in this area, the Lord is listening to you. And he will give you what you say. But when you are hungry, doesn't matter how powerful the opponent might be. I saw the springbok getting into that field. And the coach said to them, don't allow people to write your own history. You must write your own history. Never allow people to do that. He says, boys, we're going to get into that field. You are not on your own. The whole country, 60 million people, they are supporting you tonight. Get in there and remember you are fighting not just for your children, but for the whole nation. When they stood in that field, they were hungry and they were ready. Watch that game once again and you'll see what was happening. That game, it was the game of people who were hungry compared to the first game that we lost. How hungry are you, sir? How hungry are you, ma'am? And finally, a next level assignment. You need to have a next level assignment. The Bible says, God said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have seen their sufferings. I am concerned. And Moses, you must go. You must go. We need a new assignment. Align yourself to God's assignment. And the assignment of God is about people. He says, I have heard the cry of my people. I have seen their suffering. I am concerned about them. And now you must go. That is the assignment. Let us not forget, ministry is not about all these things. It's about the souls. It is about people. God says, I have seen the suffering of my people. I have heard their cry. I pray that when you sleep, you must hear the cry of God's people. You must be concerned about their sufferings. If you are the minister, you are a leader, you are not concerned. You don't hear the cry of God's people. I'm not sure what is it that will keep you motivated. But every day you must hear the cry of the people. You must see the sufferings of the people. You must be concerned just like God. I have written here, I have written a statement that you must have the same heartbeat of God when it comes to people. How is your heartbeat when it comes to God's people? Have the same compassion, the heartbeat. When people, they are living lives without God, it must be you who must tell them and say, God loves you. God does not want to see anybody perish. But most of the time, we are just in our comfort zone. There is nothing that is bothering us. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to challenge you. Let us go to the next level. Let us go to the next level. And let us be next level leaders. Get out of your comfort zone. This nation needs you, ma'am. This nation needs you, sir. This nation needs you, young man. It needs all of us. But we need to kick our comfort zone and step into the next level to His glory. God bless you.